My dear students, welcome. We are starting to discuss psychopharmacology. Supposed to be a difficult and complex chapter in pharmacology, but please remember, it's very interesting. It's the drug treatment for mental illnesses. Have a look at this colorful slide. What I've shown on this slide is there are four boxes. The first box is psychosis. And just come diagonally down, The second box here down says neurosis. Want to differentiate between these two things, what's psychosis and what's neurosis? To make it simple, when it's psychosis, the patient loses the ground reality to understand what's happening. It's a thought disorder and the whole thought process is in problem. So it's called psychosis when the patient loses ground reality. Whereas in neurosis, the reality is intact. The patient is understanding everything as it is. So that's called neurosis. Now there are two more boxes which are joined by an arrow. They're joined by an arrow because both of them are mood disorders. So if there's low mood, the upper box on the right side says depression. It's called the depressive disorder or the major depression. That's a mood disorder. And the arrow is taking you down to show another disorder of mood, and that's called bipolar disorder or it's unstable mood. So what I've done on this particular slide is there are four boxes. One box says psychosis, loss of ground reality. The second one is neurosis, the reality is intact. So this is about the thought. And the second part is mood. As far as mood disorders are concerned, there's depression and there is bipolar disorder. On the next slide, the two boxes are shown here, which are trying to differentiate between psychosis and the depressive disorder. I hope you understand by the word psychosis, you get a feeling that there's elation and there's high mood. And this high mood is due to increased amines in the brain. And these amines could be dopamine, norepinephrine, and 5-hydroxytryptamine, that's serotonin. So when there are increased amines in the brain, you're likely to get the psychosis kind of disorders. Example is schizophrenia. Whereas in cases with depression, the level of the amines, the brain catechol amines, becomes remarkably low. And there's less dopamine or less norepinephrine or less 5-hydroxytryptamine, then it manifests as depression. Let's have a look at this particular slide, which is telling you about the important actions of dopamine in the brain. The first row is saying nigrostriatal pathway. If there's less dopamine, there's Parkinson and extrapyramidal effects. We already discussed this under the module of Parkinson. In the mesolimbic cortical pathway, if there's excess dopamine, this leads to psychosis, what we are discussing now, and it's called the positive symptoms in schizophrenia. So the patient has elation, the patient has violent behavior, aggressive behavior, agitation. All these are the effects of dopamine. The third row says tubulo-infundibular pathway. Here, if there is less dopamine, it leads to, or it is as good as, less prolactin inhibitory factor. Let me tell you, dopamine is same as the prolactin inhibitory factor. So less dopamine means less prolactin inhibitory factor. So that's inhibition of prolactin inhibitory factor, inhibition of inhibition, which is going to lead to increase in the prolactin. So that leads to hyperprolactinemia. And this is why tubulo-infundibular pathway is related to the prolactin. And lastly, the medullary paraventricular pathway, that's the motor nerve of vagus, is concerned with eating behavior. So these are four areas, important areas in which dopamine acts. The next very important neurotransmitter in the brain is 5-hydroxytryptamine, which is a tryptophan derivative associated with the dorsal raphe nucleus. That's upper pons and the lower midbrain, and is concerned with control of the mood, sleep, pain, appetite, sexuality, and impulse control. Look at that. 5-hydroxytryptamine, the most important neurotransmitter in the brain, controlling so many manifestations. If there is increased 5-hydroxytryptamine, it can also lead to positive effects, that is, there is improved mood or there is high mood, also sleep, and the psychotic symptoms. Just now I said, in excess amines means it's psychosis. There are also negative effects of increased 5-hydroxytryptamine, and this leads to delayed orgasm, that's anorgasmia, a sexual dysfunction, which is commonly seen with tricyclic antidepressants, TCAs, and SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Both the groups used for the management of depression, they produce sexual dysfunction. This is a negative effect of increase in the 5-hydroxytryptamine. What happens if the 5-hydroxytryptamine is decreased? Decreased 5-hydroxytryptamine, the major amine, is decreased in the brain. It means it's depression. It means it's low mood. And especially in the patients who commit suicide, at that particular point in time, the level of the 5-hydroxytryptamine is supposed to be very, very low. So when there's less 5-hydroxytryptamine, the patient has a very poor impulse control. The patient cannot control himself. And it can either lead to, on one side, the manifestations like suicide, or on the other side, it could lead to violent behavior. Decreased 5-hydroxytryptamine is also associated with alcoholism. It's also associated with the chronic pain syndromes and sleep disorders and various anxiety disorders, especially the obsessive compulsive disorder. TCAs, just now I said, tricyclic antidepressants, SSRI, that is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and SSNRI, that selective serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, all these drugs, they inhibit the reuptake. They inhibit the reuptake of amine, and therefore there's increase in the 5-HT. So this is going to be useful in the management of mental depression, because in depression there's less 5-HT. It's going to be useful in anxiety states, various anxiety states, and it's going to be useful in pain syndromes. And this is why SSRI, they are not only used in depression, but they are also used in anxiety states, and they are also useful in the pain syndromes. The next neurotransmitter on discussion is histamine or ethylamine. Why I came to histamine? Because many of the drugs, the antipsychotic and antidepressant drugs, can block the histamine receptors in the brain. Histamine is associated with alertness, appetite, and mood. And if you block the H1 receptors, it leads to more sleep. Let me remind you of your older classical antihistamine drugs, which you used to take for common cold and cough. And whenever you take an antihistamine, probably you have to sleep. That was the older antihistamine, H1 classical antihistamine. So H1 blockade leads to more sleep, and long-term use leads to more appetite, and the patient has more eating behavior, and it leads to weight gain. This is important to know, because we are going to discuss the psychopharmacological agents, and many of them have got an additional H1 blocking effect. The drugs like antipsychotics and tricyclic antidepressants, they will be commonly producing sedation, that's H1 blocker, increased appetite, H1 blocker, and weight gain. So the adverse effects of these two drugs in the form of sedation, increased appetite, and weight gain are going to be due to their additional H1 blocking effects. Coming back to the main discussion of the illnesses which we are going to describe, so thought disorder is called psychosis, and the mood disorder is the affective disorder. It could be depression or mania, that's bipolar disease. Under neurosis, there are going to be illnesses in which the patient's ground reality is intact, and they are generalized anxiety disorders, phobia, obsessive compulsive disorder, and post-traumatic stress disorder. We shall discuss them in details at the relevant places. We start discussion of psychosis. Psychosis is a disorder of thought, and the patient loses the capacity of reasoning, the logical reasoning, looking at the reality as the world is lost. So that's called a thought disorder, and I'm calling it loss of ground reality testing. The second problem due to all this is the perception. So the person starts seeing the things and hearing the things which don't exist, or the person starts hearing or seeing the things wrongly, that's a misperception of the things which are heard or which are seen, or the person develops fixed misbeliefs. So there are three terms under perception, that's hallucinations, illusions, and delusions. If there is nothing exists and you feel it exists, it's a hallucination. You see on the ground and there is nothing and you feel it's a snake, it's a hallucination. Because you perceive something which does not exist. Next, you can have an illusion. You can look at a rope and you can feel that it's a snake. So that's illusion. That's misperception. And the third term is delusion, is a strong, firm misbelief about something which is very difficult to eradicate. So there's loss of reality tasting, the problems with the sensory perception, and lastly, there is behavioral alterations in the form of the emotion. The psychosis could be organic brain syndromes, or it could be functional. And under functional, two important conditions. One is schizophrenia, and the second one is paranoid states. And all the drugs used for these psychosis kind of things will be called as antipsychotic agents. We discussed briefly schizophrenia, which is called split mind, which is a chronic debilitating disorder, and it begins in young adulthood. The onset is in young adulthood. And there is rapid deterioration of this patient, deterioration of the mental function and behavior. This is commonly seen in patients with lower socioeconomic status, and often the patient becomes homeless, the patient becomes jobless, and many of these schizophrenics finally end into a suicide. 50% of the schizophrenics, they try to commit a suicide. So that's about schizophrenia. This patient gets two kinds of symptoms. One is called positive symptoms and the other is called negative symptoms. What's positive symptoms? Positive symptoms are in terms of high mood. So there could be aggressive behavior, aggression, there could be agitation. This patient has delusions and hallucinations, and there's paranoid behavior or paranoia, and it's all about the thought disorder. That's all called positive symptoms. Negative symptoms are exactly opposite. The patients with negative symptoms, they have a motivation. They don't want to mix up in the society. There's a kind of social withdrawal. There's flat faces. There's no expression of face. It's called blunted affect. And there is a lot of apathy and apprehension. There's impaired attention capacity also. The patient doesn't speak much. There's poor speech. And there's also cognitive impairment. I hope I'm able to raise a picture in front of you. What is negative and what's positive? Positive is about elation, about high mood, aggression, violence. And negative is about not talking to people, not mixing with people, social withdrawal, and poor speech. So positive and negative symptoms both exist in patients with schizophrenia. And a famous hypothesis for schizophrenia was called dopamine hypothesis. We said that the excess dopamine in the mesolimbic and mesocortical system is leading to all these symptoms. Later it was proven that it's not only dopamine, but more importantly, it's 5-hydroxytryptamine involvement in the pathophysiology of schizophrenia. It means that there is excess of amines. It may be dopamine, it may be 5-hydroxytryptamine. So what is to be done if we want to manage this patient? There's excess of amines, so try to block the amine transmission or try to block the receptors for the catecholamines. So we need to block the dopaminergic receptors, or we need to block the 5-hydroxytryptaminergic or serotonin receptors. So the initial research concentrated on dopamine, because it was believed dopamine is the most important substance, and most of the traditional antipsychotic agents which came in use, they were mainly the dopaminergic blocking agents. So let's come to the antipsychotics. They are not fast acting. The effect starts in about 2 to 3 weeks. Let's classify them, as I said, traditional or older agents. There are phenothiazines. There are three side chains here. There could be aliphatic chain. Then it becomes chlorpromazine or triflupromazine. There could be a piperidine chain. It becomes thioridazine. And there could be a piperazine chain. Then it becomes trifluoperazine, perphenazine, or flufenazine. The second group of the traditional older agents is butyrophenones, and the most important agent is haloperidol, and all the other derivatives and congeners like trifluoperidol, penfluridol, and benperidol and benperidol. Next, you also have droperidol in the same group, and domperidone. I hope you remember this is an anti-emetic agent, is also a butyrophenone. The traditional or older agents also include thioxanthines, that is flupentixole, zuclopentixole, and thiothixine, and the heterocyclics in the form of pimozide, loxapine, molindone, sulpiride, amisulpiride, and penfluridol. A new agent is remoxiprid, is also a heterocyclic agent. Now we come to the atypical or newer antipsychotics. What happened? As long as we were using the traditional and older antipsychotic agents, as I said, they were mainly dopaminergic blocking agents. And I hope you remember your chapter of Parkinson. If you block the dopaminergic receptors, it's going to lead to extrapyramidal reactions and involuntary movements, especially Parkinson's disease. So when the traditional older antipsychotics were used for a long period of time, the patient had to suffer from the adverse effects of the antipsychotic drugs. Now, the thought was, it's not only dopamine, but more importantly, it's 5-hydroxytryptamine excess in the brain, which is responsible for psychosis. So the scientists developed the drugs which mainly act on the 5-hydroxytryptamine. And these are the drugs which are atypical or newer antipsychotic drugs. Since they will have less effect of dopaminergic blockade, all those adverse effects of dopaminergic blockade are going to be less, are going to be minimal with the atypical or newer antipsychotics. The names are interesting. The first one is risperidone, which was very popular when it came because it was the safest agent and the best tolerated agent. Then you have clozapine, olanzapine and quetiapine, all three ending with pin, clozapine, quetiapine and olanzapine. Next there is aripiprazole, is a newer agent, and you have ziprasidone, also a newer agent, and paloperidone. So these are the antipsychotic drugs which are atypical or newer antipsychotics.